Thanks for joining us at the Business Growth Cafe, where each week we select from a menu of topics for a focused discussion with an industry expert to provide insights that can impact your business's growth. With your host, Angelo Ponzi.
I am Angelo Ponzi, your host here at the Business Growth Cafe. Thank you for joining us. Each week, we select from a menu of topics that can impact business growth to discuss with experts from a wide variety of disciplines. And today at the cafe, I'm excited to have Gary Sainer, CEO of Primero Systems, on our show to discuss the ups and downs of business growth from the perspective of a 20-year successful business. Gary, welcome.
Well, thank you, Angela. It's an honor to be here.
Yeah, I'm excited to have you on. But before we start, why don't we talk a little bit about Primero Systems, about your products and your services, so the audience can have some perspective of who you are.
Well, thank you. Yeah, we're 25 years of being in business here in the Southern California area. We've got about 70 people that we develop both custom software for larger enterprises, the mission-critical kinds of systems, and as well, we have a content management solution for, you know, entities that have multiple locations. They want to have one dashboard, if you will, to control all the web content, et cetera, the videos and images, et cetera, for multiple locations, physical locations. Our content management product is called WebTree Pro. And on a custom software side, we develop solutions for a number of different industries. Predominantly of late, it's been in the medical industry, laboratory space, pharmaceuticals, chemical manufacturing, and another large entity for us is in the travel space.
Okay. All right. Fantastic. Thank you for that. I want to start off the show asking you a question that I typically save for the end of the show, and that's, what keeps you up at night as a business owner? What are those sleepless nights while you're rolling around in bed?
Oh, my gracious. And it changes from year to year, I imagine. But of late, I think of the last 5 years or so, there's been an awful lot of consolidation with our customers. Our customers, again, are for the most part, fairly large, multi-billion dollar companies. And what we have been challenged with is a new CEO suite, CFO, CIO, come in through an acquisition or being acquired. And even though we may have done business with this organization for literally 20, 25 years.
Since the beginning.
Yeah, exactly. Well, from our beginning of our company, that's for sure. They don't know us. And by the way, they have their friends and people that they've worked with at their former companies that they bring in because they know them and they trust them. And it was pretty remarkable. 2018 should have been just a banner year with all the economic growth going on in the United States. It should have just been in our sweet spot. Technology's going nuts. Money was available. Needs are tremendous. And yet two of our largest customers turned back our efforts by 50% on both of our customers. So it was a tremendous eye-opener. Mm-hmm. And the common theme with both of them were they both had, you know, C-suite changes. And we had to prove ourselves all over again. And the good news is that in both cases, the customers have come back to us and go, "Guy, you guys are really good.
Yeah.
And we need you, and we need to add more resources from your company to our team."
Right.
So we've been very fortunate that that turned around. But that's the uncertainty of, you know, acquisitions and C-level changes in your customer base is quite threatening, could be threatening.
Right. I've been in the marketing world and owned an advertising agency for a long time. And that was probably the biggest danger that we always had is new marketing guy would come in, they'd bring in their old agency.
Yep.
We'd have to either try to defend or figure out a way to convince them we were the people.
Yep.
A lot of times we lost. That's typical. When we lost a client, it was because of that change. But let's spin off of this conversation, though, for mm-hmm. a second. So what I've told clients is you have to have relationships up and down the chain, right? So in your case, you had a new guy come in, they made changes. And so I think potentially for the listeners in this conversation, you know, the value of maintaining multiple relationships within a client base, if you will, to try to mitigate a new guy coming in and kind of changing things. Have you kind of come to that conclusion?
Well, it's yes. Our relationships with the individuals that use the software, their customers, et cetera, is always the common base, if you will. They love what they get. It's when you change that C-level that they really don't, for whatever reason, feel that they have to continue that relationship because they have others that they know have performed for them in the past. At least that's been our experience. And so, yes, I had relationships at the CEO and CIO level, and then they were gone. And so I have the new, hey, I'm Gary. I've been with your company for 9 years, providing solutions to your customers and your users. That's well and good, Gary, but we're going in a different direction. We want to go a commercial off-the-shelf solution, or no, I'm going to bring in my CIO that I had working for me at my previous company, and he's going to have a whole new technology angle that he wants to deploy, he or she wants to deploy.
Okay. Well, I can see how that definitely would keep you up at night. I know it's kept me up at night in the past, and sometimes often today it keeps me up thinking about that.
Sure.
So when you think about your business, now we're about 25 years, give or take, that you...
This month.
Premier, congratulations. That's
Thank
fantastic.
You.
So how has your business evolved? You know, if we think about growth, the show's about business growth, things that can impact growth. So as your business has evolved over the last 25 years, you know, how has that progressed? What have been some of the changes that you made and things that you helped to implement that kept propelling the growth of your organization?
I'll go back to relationships. I mean, to your point, our customers, we have one major customer that's been with us since the birth of the company 25 years ago is this month. And we have been able to sustain that kind of relationship with them. And because of them, we've been expanding into their horizontals, if you will. So we started off with one small franchise operation in San Diego, which is now part of a $35 billion company. And Primero Systems is the largest technology provider to that organization. Okay. The same is true with another major medical manufacturer, equipment manufacturer. We started with them about 22 years ago, and it was through the acquisition of their companies by larger companies that we are now a part of. Good gosh, I don't know what the market value is of this organization, but it's huge. And so it's been through relationships that we've been able to master our growth, if you will. In terms of the technology, that changes on a daily basis, it seems like. So you always were challenged with keeping current, not relaxing and saying, well, this is what we know how to do, and we know how to do it really well, so that's going to be our blueprint for the future. No, in terms of a technology company, you always have to challenge yourself to at least research and investigate mm-hmm. what's out there, what makes sense, and don't go after the brightest, shiny, item out there.
Right.
Go with something that you know has been proven. So there's a little bit of not bleeding edge, but you still need to be leading edge in your technology adoption.
Okay, so that's kind of your internal innovation, if you will, always staying on
exactly.
top of what's going on.
I'm
going to come back to some differentiators
that I
think I see for your organization, but I want to move on to another question. So when I had my marketing agency, I also was heavily involved in the action sports industry. And so I did a lot of research. And eventually I started packaging that up to have a product to sell. So I just wasn't selling time or services, right? I had a product.
Right.
And so you launched a product about 10 years ago, probably a little bit longer than that now, called WebTree Pro, which you've already mentioned.
Mm-hmm.
So how did you come to that conclusion that as a software developer and service provider that you wanted to have a product?
Interesting question. I think in almost every software engineer or company's heart is the want to not necessarily be exclusively a service business. You would like to earn revenue 24/7. You know, how do you possibly monetize that talent that you have? Because in reality, if we take a step back and look at custom software, what you're developing is a product. You're developing a product for a single buyer as compared to developing a product that the greater audience could enjoy. So it's not a technical challenge to transition from a service provider to a product provider. As I said, it's not a technical challenge. It's a heck of a marketing and sales challenge. And that's where I feel we have struggled a bit. Personally, you know, I think that one of the growth areas that I could have done better as a CEO would have been to own sales and marketing, embrace that. I had the technology aspect down. We've got, you know, great departments throughout the company that are all doing excellent work. Our sales and marketing was the one piece that truly needed to be buffed up, and I should have owned that.
Okay. Okay. Well, that's good advice. I mean, I think, and really to follow up on that, you know, for service-oriented companies that are listening today, and when they're thinking about rolling out a product, mm-hmm. is there one piece of advice or two pieces of advice you would give them?
Oh, gosh.
We need another show.
I'll repeat the sales and marketing aspect because okay. I don't think the challenge is going to be to develop a commercial-grade software product that always works. I think as a software provider, that's a given. You have to be successful in your technology suite. However, for an engineer, and most software companies start as engineering companies or with engineering talent, it is a different discipline altogether to master what it takes to successfully market and communicate and to show value to your customer base.
So basically, do not follow the field of dreams syndrome. Build it and they will come.
That's exactly right. We've been victims of that. We certainly have thought it was just a great idea. And by and large, they have been good ideas, but they've been terribly promoted to the public.
Right. Yeah, a lot of times, you know, small organizations and entrepreneurs that start to develop, I see a lot of times, and I've been guilty of this myself, we fall in love with what we've created and not necessarily doing the best job. I remember in my early days of this action sports company, talking to the CEO of OP at the time, and he said, "So are you making any money?" And I said, "Well, no." And he said, "So it's a hobby." And I went on to this whole tirade about no, it's, you know, I'm building this business, and he goes, "It's a hobby," right? Because I wasn't as a marketing guy actually doing a good job, and it kind of opened my eyes to falling in love with something I was doing and not doing a good job using the services that I provide.
Right.
So let me go back a little bit. You know, there's hundreds, thousands, maybe of custom software developers around the country, and obviously you compete depending on the vertical you might be in, but ultimately, there's a lot of competition.
There is.
In anything we look at, what are those differentiators? What's the something you can own from a brand standpoint that's ownable, leverageable, and sustainable? And you have a couple items that I see. And one, and I want to explore those. One's called PSX. One's called Pedal. Mm-hmm. That I have come to the conclusion that are kind of differentiators for your business as a way to help you separate yourself. So why don't you talk about those, how they evolved, and validate, are they differentiators for yourself?
Great question. And the PSX is an acronym that we came up with, which stands for your Primero Solutions Accelerator. That has been born out of my 30-plus years of working in the industry, knowing that every software foundation needs to be incredibly robust and incredibly complete, very solid in terms of what it provides as a foundation. The old analogy, you can't build a great building on a weak foundation. Mm-hmm. Same is true with software products and efforts. You need to have a solution that completely and cuts no corners on your authentication of your users, the roles and permissions that your users are being granted or denied, you know, the fact that it has an embedded email engine to help, you know, reset passwords, for as an example of where you would use the email engine. It's got to have a great report manager built in. So there's a lot of components that the buyer really is not considering on day one when they're saying, "I need you to build A, B, and C."
Right.
Because you start to then go, okay, well, in order to build A, B, and C, you have users, right? Oh, yes, you have users. And those users have different roles in the company, correct? Yes, they do. Do those roles differ in permissions? Well, yes, they do. So now you're starting to expand what the initial scope of the effort was in the buyer's eyes. Well, they went out and got a budget, and their expectations for a schedule is to be, you know, within these constraints. And they hadn't really considered all the other elements that are absolutely required. And so we came up with the Primero Solution Accelerator to take that completely off the table, so that when the customer comes and says, I need you to do A, B, and C, we're ready. We can deliver today all that user management, all the authentication. We have audit trails built in, just every element that is essential for a industrial grade commercial application is already built. Latest technologies, automated regression testing. I mean, there just is no shortcuts taken. And of course, if you don't have that, then you're starting to put challenges in front of your customer going, okay, well, if you want A, B, and C, we also need to do D, E, and F, but you don't have budget and you don't have time, so we're going to have to take these shortcuts to do this.
Right.
And that's just, it's just weakening your foundation.
So foundation was the word I was going to say. It's really kind of a foundation for which you start to build on.
Absolutely. And so we deliver our products to market much faster than truly any competitor can, and far more robust. And that comes with us doing nothing but enterprise level systems.
Okay. I'm always conscious of time. These things fly by a lot faster than we think. And I want to get to a couple other questions. So now, as a marketer, I don't believe in a one-size-fits-all strategy. It's integration, and every company has their own particular strategies. So thinking about that and thinking about the things we've talked about, marketing and sales are something you mentioned. So what are some of the programs that you have in place or have evolved to that you think are pretty impactful for your organization?
I'm struggling a little bit with it.
From a marketing execution, how you build sales leads and things like that.
Very good. Okay. See, again, did I underscore my lack of marketing expertise here? Yes, what we've really learned over the last 18 months or so, the value of research. We've hired a company that came in, took a look at what our products and services were, mapped them to a potential buyer base, and really helped clarify how we could address that market in a more succinct and intelligent manner. So I think market research is incredibly valuable. Just in terms of the tools and techniques that we've used, we've gone out, we've bought the mailing list. That didn't work at all. We've very successfully introduced ourselves to a broad audience using LinkedIn. Okay. So we're getting a lot of activity and a lot of interest by being able to go out to the laboratory marketplace with our offerings and expertise. And we're getting a lot of C-level responses from that.
That's great.
Which we've just generated more interest in the last 18 months than we have in the previous 24 years.
Oh, that's fantastic. That's great. I hear different success and not success stories of people using LinkedIn. So I always like to hear, because I'm a big believer in LinkedIn as well. So that's fantastic. Now, if we look in the rearview mirror, it's crystal clear on all the things we should have done.
Mm-hmm.
So if you were starting over, what would you do differently?
I'll go back to my marketing and sales. Okay. I needed to own that. I should have recognized that it was far more than just making the best software possible. It was the introduction of that software to a broader community. Okay. And yes, we've got 20-year relationships with excellent customers, but we needed to expand beyond those customer gates to new opportunities.
So for other service companies listening out there, when you think about the future then, what do you see as your biggest challenge going forward?
Gosh, it is so dynamic in terms of where the technology marketplace is going, you know, with artificial intelligence, machine learning, natural language processing, et cetera. Those, I think, are the shiny items that really do have substance to them. So if you are in the technology space, try your best to get your hands dirty with those technologies. It is completely, I want to say completely different, radically different than your traditional software development.
Okay.
So it's a new skill set that you need to learn and embrace And the value that you can offer to your customers, your legacy customers, is just tremendous. And that's where we're putting our investment in very significantly now, is the adoption of machine learning.
Okay.
And we're eager to apply the answers to that to our customers.
Okay. You must have been reading my questions upside down, because that actually was was the next one where I was going to go. So when we think about AI, I mean, so is it kind of what customers need? I mean, I've worked in doing predictive analytics and mm-hmm. things like that. So if we think about AI as that predictability, if you will, and certainly through machine learning, is this kind of coming from the outside in, from your customers in request, or is this you guys being visionaries in the sense of recognizing that you need to get on this bandwagon, so to speak, to make sure you're ahead of the curve and talking about innovation, as we mentioned before?
You know, it's rather surprising to me that we are not getting the doorbell rung by our customers for machine learning solutions. And so, yes, I think it is us recognizing that it is an absolutely monumental change to how software is going to be adopted over the next decade. But I think there's a lot of, again, larger customers are slow to embrace change. Some of them are, you know, they're AWS, Amazon Web Services fans, and that organization, Amazon, is just doing tremendous strides in availing artificial intelligence solutions to a broader base. But even at that, it takes a tremendous talent set to truly understand and be able to cause these technologies to come into reality. So that's an investment on all of our customers' behalf. And what we're trying to do is offload that investment from them. Let us take that knowledge and talent and expertise and provide it to your organization.
Okay. You mentioned AWS and Azure, right?
Yeah.
So I get asked this question about, hey, what platform is better than the other? I'm not a technologist, and I say call somebody else. But but since you're here, mm-hmm. I believe you guys are AWS.
Yes, we are.
Right? So what's the difference? Why did you pick one over the other? And what's some of the value, again, for people that are out there listening?
Yeah, well, some of the things I did right in my 25-year career is early on we hooked our wagon to Microsoft. There was a lot of competing technologies out there, but we felt that Microsoft was the one that could provide truly commercial-grade solutions. And so we hooked our wagon to them. They've not been the industry leader that we needed for at least 5 years now. And so we needed a new technology partner the new elephant in the room, if you will. Mm-hmm. And that elephant in the room truly is AWS. Microsoft, Google, the other cloud providers are certainly players in the industry, but nowhere close to the same capabilities and maturity that AWS brings to the marketplace. And so that's, for us, it was a fairly simple decision to say, you go with the market leader always, embrace their technologies, don't diversify yourself among multiple, even though the solutions we built can run on Azure, Microsoft Azure, can run in Google Cloud. They can run in AWS, but in terms of extensibility, where we're using artificial intelligence and some of the tremendous product offerings that AWS offers, it is truly, let's focus and grow the talent set in the AWS environment.
Okay. Well, thank you for that. I'm actually getting some hand signals over here from the engineer, so we are coming down to a close. So as we start to wind this down, we've talked about a lot of different things today. So as a small to medium-sized business, and I'll call it service provider, not necessarily in custom software, what are 3 or 5 tips you would give the audience from your experiences in growing a business that they should be aware of, or things that they should do? What value can you provide?
There's a number of them, right? So you have to have your competency. It's got to be peerless. You truly have to do what you say you're going to do always at the time that you say you're going to do it. One of the differentiators that I enjoy with our company is our culture. It's built on an ethics and integrity and respect. And it's, you know, it manifests itself in that we have no employee attrition. We're not the highest paying company out there, but nobody leaves us. Third, of course, is you've got to watch your dollars. always be fiscally conservative. Make sure that you've got a return on investment with everything. And I may have mentioned this before, marketing. You need to own your marketing. You can't outsource that, I believe, as effectively as you can promote yourself. Use that outsource to guide you, but then own it.
Okay. Well, Gary, thank you so much. I really appreciate it. It's been a really good stimulating conversation. I'm sure the audience is going to really benefit from this. So why don't you give, we're going to wind up. So why don't you tell the listeners how they can reach you and Primero Systems, website, email, all that good stuff.
Okay, great. Thank you again, Angelo. My name is Gary Sainer. I'm CEO of Primero Systems. Our website is www.primerosystems.com. Email address is gsainer at primerosystems.com. And I look forward to answering any questions that your listeners may have. You can just contact us. We have a contact us page, of course, on our website, powered by WebTree Pro, of
course.
There
you go. Oh, thank you so much. Thank you again for those of you joining us at the cafe today. You can find out more about me and read my blogs at theponzagroup.com. Connect with me on LinkedIn as well, also on Facebook. And you could subscribe to the show at businessgrowthcafe.com, or we are now on iTunes, Google Play, Spotify, Stitcher, and coming soon to Streaker, SoundCloud, iHeartRadio, to name a few, and others around the world. Join me next week for lunch at the Business Growth Cafe.
Thank you for listening to today's discussion at the Business Growth Cafe with your host, Angelo Ponzi. Take a moment to subscribe to this podcast and visit our website at www.businessgrowthcafe.com. Read Angelo Ponzi's blogs at www.theponzigroup.com.